I don't think this is working, so we'll do away with this if that's okay with everyone. It's a correct for that. Okay. It's working? You're getting it? Okay, cool. So, hi guys, I'm Nikhil here, and this is my partner
Hi, I'm Anand, and this is my partner Nikhil. Partner in the sense at Q Pursuits. So just in case you guys were wondering, no. Although we totally support the cause. Right. So what we're here today to talk about is something that unfortunately is an antithesis to what is happening here on one level. And on the second level, it's an oxymoron. The antithesis is the fact that we're not talking anything about technology. The oxymoron is that what we are going to talk about, that is unlearning your way to success, is something that we learned. So in that sense, we're being a bit hypocritical today, but I think, but yeah, but that's life. Two things you need to remember. One, this is not a prepared session. We don't have slides for you. We don't have prepared material that we're going to refer to. It's going to be something that we want to talk to you about and engage you in a conversation with, right? The second thing is.
So, basically, this Barcamp has been something about education. We've had a couple of people coming up to me. We've had, Vivek coming up and Vijay talking to me about education. We've had Jasmeet's talk just now about how technology and education can go hand in hand about things. And all of this is happening, all these changes in the field of education, all these new players coming in, the sheer number of startups, the number of businesses that are getting into an auxiliary education apart from the mainstream education is because there is a deficiency in the present education system. If the education system that we have right now was working fine, we wouldn't need other people like, Jasmeet and me coming in and trying to sell people other stuff and having to teach in a manner that is different from what is mainstream. So just to give you an example, I think Anand's going to go into.
Right. So quite interestingly, this is a question that I was asked in a B school interview. Right? The question I was asked is, and this I will throw open to all of you, how would you estimate the amount of paint that is consumed in Bangalore City? Anyone?
There is just an interactive session, please, like talk to us.
Yeah, otherwise we really don't have enough to talk about. We really don't have enough to talk about until you guys talk about. Sorry? Millions of gallons. So how do you. Okay.
Any other ways?
Any other ways? Okay. 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 Any other way? Okay.
If this is a question in your 10-standard math class, how would your teacher go about this?
And oh, please remember, you need to write statements. You need to write statements. I'm looking for the number. So you tell me, you give me the number with your approach. Okay, so this was opened up to a bunch of 10th graders at a fairly renowned Bangalore school in the south of Bangalore. Was he right? Okay. So this is how they typically built their answer. Point number one, total number of buildings in Bangalore. Pointer number two, average height of all buildings in Bangalore. Number three, total floor area. Calculate the total surface area of each wall. Sorry? No, it's not a million-dollar project. It's a 10-standard question. It's a simple question. No, no, but we hope, maybe. And then they got into these iterations. You calculate volume, then you calculate surface area from that, and then you you calculate an average for one locality, you extend it to all other localities.
And they thought they were being clever. The sad part is that. So the point being, I mean, running down to the point being that the education system kind of, it doesn't force you to think in such a manner, but it encourages this kind of thinking.
I went with the same answer, but I was clever enough to figure out midway that, hang on a minute, this is not what they want. So I said, I'll go to every paint distributor in the city, get their reports, and then tell you the number. And then I was asked, why didn't you tell me that first? I said, I'm just giving you more options, So I still don't know if I'm in yet. I still don't know, but we'll see.
Yeah, so the point being that this kind of a rabbit hole mechanism of thinking is what is encouraged. So how many of you here know about the Bloom's levels? The folks in education? Okay, so there's something called the Bloom's levels. Like, most of us go through our education as students and we look at it from one point of view, that there's a question and it requires an answer. From the teacher's point of view, there's something called as the Bloom's levels, which they look into while you're setting your paper or making any course material by itself. Most of the stuff that happens in our education system is on the first level of the Bloom's level, which is the knowledge level or the remember level. Everything that we need to jot down on our exam sheets is via memory. We have to remember, we have to mug it up, stay up till like midnight or 2 a.m. On the day before the exam, then go and write it down on a piece of paper. Whereas actually education contains 4 levels, Bloom's levels. The most basic being, of course, remember and knowledge. The next one being comprehend, where you understand. The third one being the application bit of it. And the fourth being the analytical level, which is, a comprehensive level, including all 3 levels, where you apply concepts that you understand and then remember something else. So that's the fourth level is something that we rarely touch upon before a graduate level. But at least the first three, if we can have a schooling system where kids are not just required to mug stuff up, where we can have kids actually understanding a concept. Like, just the other day, we were at a school, again in South Bangalore, and while we were talking to them about a certain thought camp that we were conducting, the teacher who was taking the class, who's the unfortunate lady whose class we had to interrupt, was teaching them De Morgan's Laws. Now, these kids weren't interested in what she was teaching, and they didn't seem to care about anything other than taking down notes like stenographers. They were just jotting down, Venn diagrams and
with a
compass and all of that. But I don't think there were many kids in that room who were getting how important the Venn diagrams are. And you want to take over?
Right. So quite simply, we interrupted that class only to, shamelessly sell our thought camp that we're conducting for a price for them. But we interrupted the class, and in the middle of the session, I asked him, do you guys even know what De Morgan's laws are going to be useful for you? This is the silence I got. Right? So the fundamental problem with the Indian education system, which I faced as I schooled, and I schooled in a rather prestigious school myself, the worst thing that can happen to a student is when they give you marks for steps. It is the savior for an engineering student, but it is absolutely criminal to do that at a school level because of 2 reasons. One, it sends you down a very structured approach in terms of thought. So when I ask them how much paint is consumed in Bangalore City, the only thing they can do is think in a structured way. The only thing they can do is to try and systematically find a number. There is absolutely no, maybe it's a lack in ability, or it's just they're not sensitized to different approaches to solving an issue, especially if it doesn't employ concepts that are used in schools. So therefore, what we realized is that moving from I schooled, moved into studied engineering, and then started working. When I started working, I realized that, hang on a minute, there are things that I need that I can't do this way. Right? If someone comes up to me and asks me, I do a lot of client service. So if my client asks me, can you tell me how many resources you're going to take for this particular task? Or can you give me a ballpark estimate of something? I cannot sit and give him statements. I cannot sit and count in the regular classical mathematical way. This is when we realize that the fundamental approach that is being taken at the school level in terms of education is seriously flawed.
Okay. So basically, I mean, Anand's a good kid, he's a good student, and he's going about it, and he realized this very late that, you know, shortcuts are important. My handling sucks, man. If I write a lengthy answer, the teacher won't even read that, and she'll be like, nah, zero or half or something. So very early on, very, very, very early on in life, I had to resort to shortcuts, even on paper or otherwise in life, to show people that I'm clever. But then that was never rewarded. And later on in life, it was pushed into my brain that I have to start writing structured answers and show steps and show them that I'm thinking in a manner which I am not. I'm seriously, I'm getting to the answer directly. But you want me to tell me, want me to tell you what the intermediate steps ought to be just because you need those intermediate steps? But right now, I've come to the realization that these are not things that ought to be told. Like, a kid should be allowed to learn a concept. And what we concentrate on is teaching people concepts and teaching people skills and teaching people topics. But the education system forgets to teach people how to learn. Most people don't know how to learn. If we knew how to learn, then half the problems would be solved. We wouldn't require an additional thought camp where I teach people how to, you know, interact with a bunch of people. There wouldn't be, you know, a class necessary for me to tell people how to write business mails and all that kind of stuff. So
essentially, the thought camp that we are conducting is essentially damage control to ensure that students don't learn a little too much in school. We're trying to ensure that, okay, if you learn something, let's try and get them to unlearn a little bit of it.
Is not equal to forgetting. We're not making them forget any of the stuff they've learned. Just telling them that they've got to forget what they mean. They've got to have a sensor of sorts on what they will be using and what they'll be using just to get marked.
And unfortunately, the two of us are going to be personally responsible for a lot of 10th graders in that school bungling up their 10th standard exams this year. I'm very sure. But I know that going forward, the approach that we are trying to inculcate into these kids, it's going to help them do bigger and better things quicker and quicker and quicker, right? The second thing, what he mentioned, like for example, you know, I'd like to take if you don't mind, a quick survey. How many of you are computer science graduates or information science graduates? Right. Now, I was speaking to, where's Vinay? Oh yeah, hi. So I was speaking to him yesterday when we were trying to understand from him I can't put a for loop for nuts. So I'm not the best person to talk about how he had to unlearn what he learned in his engineering days and apply them to what he's doing now, right? So what?
First, can we get a small poll? How many of you are working on stuff that you learned in like school or university? Yeah, you're still doing the same stuff that you. Yeah, so that's the thing, right? Most of us would raise like half a hand if we were allowed. Some of them, yeah? Not all of, I mean, I'm not saying all of them, but at least like if you, how many people who studied like mechanical engineering are working for Toyota in the R&D division and not, you know, as a PR or a customer service, whatever? Who goes to Infosys? Oh,
okay. Right. So, oh, if there is someone from Infosys, we sincerely apologize.
Voting for no, not
okay. So, anyway, going forward, we're not trying to talk to you about how relevant what you learned in college is, but what we want to learn from you is there something that you learned in college that you had to completely unlearn to actually do your job right? Come on up.
There was a lot of labs in college which were on specific situations, problems given to us, and they expected us to solve it. Every time I used to rack my brains like what to do. These were like communication design, some labs. So I used to copy the answers in the end from a person and somehow got pass grades, like very low grades, because I could never explain what. But then I went to office, I was given a problem and I was explicitly asked, ask as many questions as you can, go to the internet, do cheat, whatever you can, but in the end deliver like to this standard. And I thought, I never thought it like this. I mean, this is the process, learning process. There I had to be the right answer, and asking was a sin. Here asking is encouraged and I have to deliver the right answer. So I worked a lot, and in the end somebody asked me, yaar tujhe college or school mein kya end lagta hai? Kuch nahi yaar, college mein lab 3 ghante ki hoti thi, yahan 8 ghante ki hoti hai, bas yahan puchna allowed hai.
Sorry. One more interesting thing that I heard, maybe a small tidbit. You know, when we all started using computers, how we used to look at the keyboard, type, look at the screen, type, look at the screen. You know, we estimated that if you're writing about a 5,000 word code, if you... 5,000 line code. You're actually, you know, if you stop vis-a-vis, you know, you touch, you know, looking at it, typing, and then looking at your screen, as against actually being a good typist, you're actually saving about 25 minutes end to end overall. It's a huge amount of time. But what I realized is, when I, although I don't code, I realized that not looking at the keyboard when I'm trying to type is extremely hard, even when I can type, right? So these are reflexes that you need to unlearn. And these are some things that schools don't tell you. Nobody tells you about this. Nobody tells you that your life is going to be much simpler if you stop doing this right now. Nobody tells you all of that. And
in line with the coding thing, because I mean, I'm not a coder either, but the other day I met this friend of mine who had just appeared for an interview with one of these biggie e-commerce sites. And I asked him what the interview was. He's like, yeah, online, they just gave me a question, I had to solve it. I'm like, how much time? Like, they give you 2 hours. It's like, there's this interview street thing. They just give you a problem. I'm like, so you got the solution? Huh, everyone gets the solution. Like, dude, like, back in school, like, computer lab, he tells me, MATLAB, me, you have to get a thing. And if I get it right, I get it right. That's it. I get full marks. Like, dude, no. Then he's like, what is it? I'm like, timing. Did you finish it within like an hour or something? Yeah, I took like an hour and 25 minutes, but that's not what matters either. I'm like, okay, what matters? How quickly, how efficient the program is, how much time, the run time and stuff. So I'm like, is this what they taught you in school? And like, and he went to quite a prestigious university and stuff. He's like, no, this is not what I was taught. So that whole naive concept of getting the answer right and getting it fast is not what matters. It's delivering, and it's efficiency, and it's being, you know, good at what you do, irrespective of what the environment is. So these are things that the education system does not actually look at. And there are these deep-rooted concepts on the subconscious level that you don't even know, that you are unlearning every minute, every time you work, every new experience is making you do that. So that's something I think we need to work on the whole. I think you'd like to add?
One small little thing. Something that we will propose to a few of the schools that we are currently working with is to stop giving students extra answer sheets when they are writing exams. We don't want them to do it. The reason is two things. One, when you know, one is the bigger picture where you learn to work within constraints. The second is actually when you place these restrictions on them, you're actually going to ensure that this kid will get it right the first time, that he doesn't spend time canceling stuff that he didn't need. He's going to use as few lines as possible, as little space as possible. Let's say it's a math paper. He'll use as little space as possible to find the same solution. And these are things that schools conveniently ignore. They'll say, oh, the kid's handwriting is so big and, you know, he needs more space. No.
Can I add a point here?
Yes.
You do exactly what I was about to say. So if you can do well in exams, you become a storyteller eventually. Yeah. So that's the thing. Yeah.
Isn't that how you learn?
Yeah.
make a mistake, okay, it didn't work out, just more time, I can try something else.
True, that makes sense. I'm actually with them on this. You should give people second chances. Also, last benchers, you know.
Just because it was inconvenient for you to answer that question.
No, I'm saying no. No, lengthy answers are one thing. Additional sheets are another thing altogether. If precision is one thing. Experimenting is something that ought to be.
No, to answer your question. To answer your question. Yeah.
Push them on students eventually in the exam. Is it going to actually give
some... Exactly. At the grassroots level,
so
it must be, you know, dealt with.
Starting from the bottom,
you
are not...
You have to start with
school.
But how will it change the board from correcting the same way?
Go to okay, two questions here.
Let me answer his first. I'll forget his question. One second. To answer his question, most schools and colleges give you answer booklets. And the answer booklet is a fair estimation of how much space you'd need. From their point of view. Sorry, I didn't get you. No. No. Because I'm trying to boost efficiency. I'm looking at elegant answers, and I'm not looking at stories.
No, I think we're missing the point here. So, exactly. So you need to write the. So. Exactly. True.
So again, are we not going back to rote?
So
are we not imposing another constraint to lift another one? Is it not trading one constraint for another, frankly speaking?
So the point goes back to this. The answers you get depend on the questions you ask. If you're asking the right questions, you get the right answers. Right now, the education system is testing. There's a ratio in the Bloom's level, right? So the remember level is what is being tested now. And people just mug up paragraphs from the textbook and come over, and then they write. That is why they're writing. That's not something that we should be, you know, going about with. But if there's a comprehend question, if there's a question that requires the student to understand or analyze, if I give him like a scenario and tell him to write an analysis of the same, and if he can write out that in an elegant manner, if he can take 10 pages, I will have the patience to read that. Sure. Of course, very, very subjective. Sure. Certainly. To an extent. That makes sense to an extent, but...
Is it not equivalent to that? Let's just have objective questions. Elegance A is A, B is B. Choose an answer.
The creativity is lost there.
That's what you're actually doing in different words.
Exactly. No, I'm saying ask the right questions.
What I'm still saying is...
Creativity is not opulence.
Creativity is...
No, you shouldn't limit. If you would have to limit the space if you ask the right questions, is what I'm saying.
I do not directly correlate creativity to opulence in...
Take the notes, write it on textbook, copy it down into your notebooks, copy it from the textbook. Okay, I was so lazy, what I did is I cut the papers off from the textbook and paste them in the textbook. I thought it's a really cool idea, and our kids are like, dude, we are like suffering for 5 hours a day. The next day, I got beaten up by the teacher. And when I grew older, I realized that the teacher didn't beat me up because I did a mistake. Teacher beat me up because she wants none other guys to follow me. From that, what I understood is, it's about, you know, getting 50 people together and thinking and standardizing a mechanism for them.
True.
Assembly language.
This is the problem. I mean, why are we into this whole system of, you know, why should we always teamwork? Why should we always work together?
Yes.
So, I think that's
isn't efficiency also a counterpart of that right now? What I'm saying is, why are we aiming at efficiency? Because industries need it. Isn't that the thought of the past now? That's what industrial revolution is. Efficient education.
alternate education? What do you guys think about alternate education? Very specifically, actually. And what do you guys think about alternate education?
It can be a supplement.
Why?
See, right now, if you want to go mainstream with alternate education, give me an example. Homeschooling?
No, I'm not going mainstream. I'm saying, I don't know. I'm just trying to understand what do you guys think about alternate education. Why is it alternate education?
No, but before that, I'd just like to clarify. Because I think the one point, the smaller picture that's lost is that when I talk about efficiency in writing an answer or, you know, in an elegant answer, I'm looking at an efficient thought process that is reflected by the answer.
Let's leave efficiency
so
to communication in English classes.
Because
rather.
I would not... No. Math?
Depends. I'm saying depends.
Math requires
if efficiency. I write x plus y equal to 10... That's one. If I also explain, would you cancel it?
Constraints and efficiency.
Yeah.
No, but let's talk
no,
about
I,
alternate
is,
education.
There are two ways. There are two ways.
Yeah.
I can write x plus y equal to 10, or I can draw a graph, which is more elegant. Why? And which is wrong? Which is right? Which one would you cancel?
Whatever
again.
Asked of you is what
it.
You
it.
No, what is the interpreter? What is
okay.
That's wrong. No, that's wrong.
Yeah.
It's not 1 plus 1 equal to 10.
No, it isn't.
No, it isn't. What I'm saying is, it can also be expressed by a graph.
Yes.
It can be expressed in one line to an equation.
Do you know what is more elegant? The fact that a student can relate
all the four together. So what I'm saying is, how do you choose
an
equation?
Is a number.
That rewards that is what I'm saying.
So how would changing sheets of paper, reducing the number of sheets of paper, create a system that rewards that? No.
Okay. See, changing sheets of paper is just one aspect. He's stuck up on that. So what I'm saying is, that's a problem. It won't work if we do that now.
That's precisely what I'm saying. It's because we're not asking the right questions. The questions that we're asking now, in papers, in schools, in colleges, give you that liberty to write random stories. I can write the lyrics of a Limp Bizkit song in between and write meaningful stuff in the first
what's
and last.
What's wrong in that? That's what I'm saying. What's wrong in that? Do you only need engineers and is there a school?
No.
Is
what way is it related to the subject, which is wasting the paper, right?
That's another headmistress talking.
That
should not be the case.
Headmistress? And the thing is, the headmistress will not give marks for that. You
yes,
random
so
writing.
No, what I'm saying
is,
no. Let's get back to...
Just look at the length of the answer.
Ah.
Exactly.
Train the teachers.
So, exactly what I'm saying.
No.
So, the whole system
and
needs
to
overhaul.
And what I'm saying is, if a child writes a poem,
Can I make a shameless plug here? It's a little too late to start training teachers right now. So, what we are doing is training the students who will go on to become better teachers. Is what I've.
Exactly. That's
is what we're talking.
Let me just button here. Alright. So, a lot of examinations which not only test your English but creative thinking skills, etc. Like SATs and your GREs,
yeah.
Standardized testing, right, will always put a limit on the amount of words you can
yes.
use. The reason is that they want you to express your creativity,
yes, that's what I was
but at the same time, so that there is what you can express a lot more in a lot less number of words.
Exactly. So this is one point here I'd like to like.
How many of you here have heard of the fog index? Yeah, sure. So I'll just go ahead with the fog index is basically a number that's given. So say I take a sample of your writing, I run it through an online system where it says it calculates your fog index, and it provides a number which states that those are the number of years of formal English education required for a person to completely comprehend what you had written. What do you guys think the average fog index of an Indian is? Like an urban Indian. I'm talking about an urban Indian. No? Surprisingly, it's somewhere around 9 to 13. We're pretty good. And we're made to write all these complex words and complex sentences, which would require an actual British student to learn 9 years of proper English in school to figure out what we've written. And some of us even have really shabby 16, 18 scores, which is something you can boast about in like a, you know, niche audience. Chetan Bhagat is like 6s. This is going on YouTube. Kidding.
You don't know, no. Chetan Bhagat, it doesn't matter. Anyway, it's going to be made into a movie very soon.
So yeah,
so you don't have to bother yourself with the English. Look, again, we cannot, there's no one solution. There is no single solution. Okay.
Exactly.
Well, you know.
Degree what you have got, whatever it is, mechanical, electrical, it is in no way useful to the work what you are doing. I think among 100 of us who have done our degree, the work what you, maybe 1% has got, is using the talent or that education, whatever he has learned. So in what way it is useful to the present generation? For us though it is over. For me though it is over. For you, you are in the second stage maybe. How about the kids who are just coming up? They're saying the same thing. The technical thing, okay, these iPods are given to the young ones, they're using, they're so used to even the pre-nursery kids that they don't want to write the horizontal line and the vertical line.
That's fault of a parent.
Fault of a parent, even schools are providing that, no?
It's parents who are asking.
Yeah, exactly.
Parents like schools.
Yeah. And the schools are, after all, they are like the...
You know, quite interestingly, three of us were at a school yesterday.
Yeah.
Yesterday, you know...
And then there's another child who is not given. So the other parent is forced to give that child.
No, a very simple question. How do you choose a school?
We have no choice at all.
No, you should have. That's what I'm saying. So the fault is not of a child here. There are systems in place.
Birth of a child, it's not its choice. Where's the education system?
The industry itself has a role.
Quite interestingly, as I was saying.
Just about yesterday at around 10 in the morning, we were at a school, the three of us. And what was... They already know. Right. So his, the way he sold his school was, ours is the first school in Bangalore to have an Apple computer lab.
He says he has 40 Macintosh computers.
Yeah.
And he's like, he's proud of that. He has. No, unfortunately, it was the same Ambedkar and Gandhiji, but okay.
It's like, I don't care, I'm crazy. Yeah. Going to schools, ascertainment system, because you can change the teachers how they teach the students, but effectively, if they go and write those same answers in their own exams, they will fail. They will fail because at the level, at the lower level, they will fail.
So the trick is to have parallel systems of education running, like he said, alternative systems of education. Right now, you have to start. You have to start somewhere. You have to take a proactive step. We can't say the board exams have been going on and they will go on and that everyone has to mug stuff and go on.
But they aren't. The 10th standard is...
They aren't relaxing anyway. Have you met a like 16-year-old these days? Or 10th standard... 16. No, a little... They're too busy then. 11th and 12th, kids are going for, you pick any three random letters from the 26 letters of the alphabet, they form an examination. And every kid who's in 11th or 12th is busy preparing for these examinations. And there are prisons in place all over the city which claim to, you know, have a foundation course or a roof course or a terrace course or some other course for them.
But then again, wherever you start.
Yes.
That's what my feeling is, that wherever you start, the particular audience that you have targeted might be at a loss when competing with the rest of the crowd.
But this will pay off. It will pay off.
Pay off excellently in the, when they, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah,
in the long run. Big picture.
Yeah. But again, how many people are going to accept the big picture? I mean, come on.
See, that's the point.
Looking at the big pictures is something that I don't think... four generations have been trained on.
So we have to change that. Like, I have a friend who's like 5'2", and they're looking for a bride for him and stuff, and people are talking, and he keeps complaining about how he's short and stuff. So one of my friends, his solution was, next 4 generations marry Russian ballerinas. You're set, the gene pool is set. So, I mean, there has to be a drastic change somewhere at some point, continuously, to bring in a new system. I'm kidding. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Yes, yes, he is, yes. Yeah, yeah, Shugat Mitra. Yeah.
What if all the existing structure in place, if we have this alternative structure, and if we can put out series of people who have designed things, built things using in this alternate structure,
exactly.
Isn't that a better CV than what people will...
Most certainly.
And that's something that we're working about and trying to get at that. Because we can't tell a bunch of kids to just go flunk their 10th boards just because we're teaching them stuff that they'll be using once they get into an entrepreneurial job. But these are skills, and I mean, come on, we are intelligent kids. There are kids, the 16-year-olds today are a lot more, you know, enterprising than what we were when we were 16. And they can juggle a couple of things. They can actually, if they can go for a chess class and something else and swimming and music and manage to get a 90% in their boards, they might as well get an 88 and learn something that they can get, you know, use 20 years down the line, 10 years down the line. So that's what we're working at. Sure thing.
How many of us actually know what we want to do from our life?
We don't.
We change the path.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
Like when you were 3, I mean, when you just started growing up, you had a vision ki, okay, you have thoughts like, I want to be a doctor or an astronaut.
True.
When you grow up, it might be something, I want to be a journalist. But then as further on life goes on, you choose to be someone else.
Exactly. So we're not defining paths, we're opening up paths. An education system that will give people the opportunity to,
not
you know, ponder upon themselves. Yeah, not everyone has to do an engineering degree, write the GRE, go to an Ivy League school, finish their MS. Are people taking them? Wow. Okay.
And till now, I see there are scopes, and that is one college I saw that they used to send a form to all the pass out graduate students after a year that they graduate, asking what are the subjects which you are actually using, and what are the subjects that you think will, you know, impact better education. And
okay.
At that time, 2 years, 3 years back, they introduced digital marketing and
okay.
UI/UX, which I don't think any other college.
You by any chance work for this college now?
I don't work for the college.
Okay.
So I'm not happy. And I tell you, my mom wanted me to be a doctor. My dad wanted me to be an engineer. And I decided one thing, that I'll be anything, but I would not be something which is mainstream or which is expected of me.
But that's bad for
the next.
What do you do? Yeah.
The norm is, there's a popular name these days.
That's your choice.
Yeah,
that's
first become an engineer and then become
then
a doctor. That's your choice.
So you first, you should change that. So you first get into an engineering college.
Okay, he's
going
to
be
going to
the
7th semester.
You then your placement decides what you're going to
do. Exactly, yeah.
Just yes. So one question, I think. Let's have 1 minute discussion.
Sure.
Isn't all of this a speculation?
You
don't
decide. All of what?
All of that we have discussed today, is this a speculation?
No, it's not.
It's a fair question, frankly. Let's not base everything that we have to change. Let's not base a revolution on speculation. First thing, is it a speculation? I'm not saying it's bad or good. I'm just trying to set the ground. It's a speculation.
It's not, we're doing.
But you're speculating
the results. This is a speculation. What I'm saying is you're doing it, but results are too far-fetched. It's too down.
Yes.
It's too down the line. One.
Yeah.
Second,
are there certain what should I say, microsystems that you've seen which resonate to what you've done?
Yes, there are. So basically, the
B schools in the US have a ratio when it comes to the Bloom's levels themselves. And there's a certain ratio, like if there's a paper that has to last for like an hour, you shouldn't be testing the student for more than 20 minutes on memory. Sure. On the current education system in India? Well, we...
What are our options?
Yeah.
Is it an ICQ?
See, okay. No. Okay. Yeah, you did, yes. Okay.
What kind of schools will accept them is something that will also should also gauge. One. Second, what's happening? What are the school teachers doing? There are new schools coming up. So, should you target the schools which are already there, DPSs?
Yeah, of course, yes.
Or should you target the schools which are coming up now from ground? Okay. There are a lot of things that you should talk about without before you go into this level of analysis.
We are doing that. We are
so
doing that.
So, there
obviously.
Is okay. a lot of parallels which are missing as of now, which seems in the talk.
In answer to your question, which is more an observation, and I'll let you make the conclusion. List out the top 5 schools in Bangalore from the past 25 years in their presence in terms of academic rigor.
I know two. Again, not from the stats, not from what 5 years have happened. What I've seen, one was MAIS, the way they are. I don't know about the fee structure and anything.
That's Malayadi.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. The way they are trying to get a lot of new things in is quite different. One. Second was. School which is closer to my office.
Where's your office?
Basundgudi, Gandhi Bazaar. Achieve International School or something. Achieve School of something.
Achieve School of Excellence?
I think so, yes. I think Achieve. So they have a very interesting studio. It's a school which doesn't have a ground, which is one thing I hated about it. But when I went in there, the kind of sessions they had was different. They don't have classrooms, 10th, 11th, 12th. They have math studios, science studios, and classrooms. It's not that classrooms are fixed and teachers come in. There are rooms fixed in which students come and go by. And there are labs, very specific labs, which talk about what that subject is about. So it's quite different. What I'm saying is, the Indian education system is itself evolving, not just in the alternate system,
true.
But the mainstream also. Because, as I said, we talked about alternate systems.
But
as
is it
in
mainstream enough?
We have different versions of what the mainstream is.
No, as in
no,
I'm
still going
in mainstream.
What I'm saying is,
no,
the mainstream...
IBS,
yes,
yes.
The
IB system works that way itself.
Yep.
It's an international system. That's why.
No, the
Malaya
ICSE, ICSE also.
Malaya
has ICSE.
No, ICSE has those 13 papers.
I know. What I'm saying is, it's not about the papers. Why are we coming back to papers?
I'm saying that's what the schools are going to deliver.
You are saying, right now, you are judging the results on paper, frankly speaking. You're not talking about what a student does, you're talking about what a student writes.
Yeah.
Let's
as an example,
that's not the only
as
case.
A reflection.
Oh, it isn't. That's only 1 hour that he spends a day to write that exam. That's one.
True. Agree.
I'm not gonna use that first of all to make an assumption what a child has learned.
Agree.
So if we do that, that's a similar mistake.
True.
To what the education system is. If
true.
An hour paper is enough to judge a student's ability that he has learned in a year, I totally don't support the notion personally.
True.
I have no regrets so as to whatever you guys think.
Yes,
but
I do agree with you. But the thing is, okay, you don't agree, I don't agree with 1 hour paper. But PUC admissions, what he's going to get is the same 1 hour what he has written.
What I'm saying is, ma'am, maybe a day or two later, you join Aam Aadmi Party or BJP.
No, no. Actually, no for Aam Aadmi Party. No, no. Let's not discuss politics.
Like
okay.
Us is only going to go there and change. So it's not maybe about reform, it might be about revolution, but someone has to do it. And it's not going to be someone who has seen or worked for 25 years in Infosys. It's some not back in Infosys. What I'm saying is, I think we are doing the same mistake. The current trends in industry are also changing. One, very specifically coming to design and tech again, these are tools which were not available earlier.
Yeah.
It's opening a lot of avenues. So maybe homeschooling
yeah.
is a very specific area that you guys can target.
that will be an audience which will be very susceptible to your ideas because they already need help. They don't have systems in place.
So what I'm saying is this.
I agree. There are a lot of schools that are trying new things. If they're already trying new things and if they feel they're going to work, I wouldn't offer my services to them. If they have an experiment in place and if they feel they're going in the right track, I will offer my help in any way I can. But I will not offer them something, you know, something radical that's different from their radicality. If they're doing something that's not mainstream and if they feel their students are going to benefit from that, well and good. If there's a school that is going by the conventional method, that is where I want things to change. So let's be part of the change is what I'm saying.
Let's drive the revolution.
So you introduce new concepts. You teach them things that aren't taught in schools. A school will not teach them.
True.
But I can only handle one school. It's three people. I can go into one school and conduct a batch in the morning and conduct a batch in the afternoon and another in the evening. It's a start. We just started. I'm 23. Exactly. Time's up. Okay, I think we're running out of time, so like I'll just, yeah.
Let me just try to summarize what happened.
Go on, yeah, please. Sure.
But by changing the present.
You cannot change the present.
You can't change the present.
Neither can you change the past, neither you can change the present. You can analyze what has happened in the past and what's happening here.
True.
So that the effect is there. So what I'm
saying
is
that isn't that how every major change happens?
But that's not being seen. What I'm saying is you're not comparing the present to the past. To lead to a future.
I'm sorry, how?
There are two points. What I'm saying is you want to draw a pattern.
Yeah.
You're taking a single point, I'm saying draw a line.
What pattern are we drawing?
You have to extrapolate what has happened. What I'm saying is the system still at fault? Or, first of all, you're talking about a disease system. All of us are talking about a disease system.
I'm not.
To a good extent. What are you talking about?
True, of course. The system is disease. Does anyone deny that?
Conflict of opinions. Let's not go there. So, what I'm still saying,
I think that's a little unfair.
What I'm still saying is, here a lot of things are backing on the notions. If I still go for a vote, a lot of us are talking about disease system. I'll tell you the reason. We have only talked about past. I'm saying, is the system diseased as of now also? What is the state of the flu?
It is.
What
it
is the state? But how much? To what extent? What is the state of the flu?
It's very bad. It's as bad.
Very bad? You're being as
I'm saying,
unelegant in your answer as you expect.
It's 99.999% lethal.
I can say it's 100%.
And we need a solution with salt.
Same 48 days like our party voted with it. It's now continuing the same thing.
I'm saying subjective examples are different.
Sir, if you say he says 99%, if you say 90%, isn't 90% even that, isn't that bad?
I'm saying 10%
is
bad.
Actually 90, is it 10, is it 5, has it changed? Can you take cues from the things that have changed? So what I'm saying is,
of course it's changed.
The illness has changed from last year.
Okay, you're jumping in the well after a 1 hour talk about a subject that we've spent, 3 months researching on? You're not. So it'll take a while. Obviously, we can take this offline and we can talk about it. But the thing is, obviously, there's a change. Things are much better today than they were yesterday. And we hope it'll be much better tomorrow than they are today. And each step we take is a small step and we hope it makes a change. And that's all we can do. We can't go for drastic steps right now. Yeah, I guess so.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, what was the topic about? Yeah. So, yeah. So, yeah, thank you.
No, I think what we take is you guys are doing some pretty good work.
Okay.
At least started doing it.
I'm glad you think so.
At least you're trying, right?
Sure thing, yeah, we're trying, man. Yeah, we're trying. True, thank you so much. Sure thing.